Zion Entertainment. Zion Entertainment.
Okay, we're here with the cast and the producer, editor, writer, sound technician, everything, everything of Target Practice. Okay, so introduce us to the different guys.
Rich Riddell, producer, director, writer, editor, caterer, Target Practice. I'll let you introduce yourselves.
Pass it around.
Joey Lanai,
Paul.
Sean Christopher. The guy that says nothing. Stunt coordinator.
That's because you say nothing because you have your finger over the top of the mic when you're talking.
Hey, how come I didn't have a speaker?
Eric Dean, Mark.
Elton Williams, Ron.
X-Factor.
Richard DiGiulio, Jeff, the bedrock of the film.
Yeah.
Wow. The inciting
more
incident.
Like the concrete shoes on the film.
Hey, was that racial slur?
Easy.
Okay. Now,
cutting room floor.
Okay, tell us about the plot of the film.
We kill Richard DiGiulio. plot of the film. Five guys on a fishing trip run into a homegrown, a terrorist training camp for homegrown terrorists. Uh-oh, some Solomon Hoyle, ladies and gentlemen! Nice entrance!
Yeah!
Introduce yourself.
Hello. My name is Solomon, King Solomon Hoylett. Okay, I'm playing, yes, I'm playing,
the Mr.
Wild and Crazy Hakeem Al-Khazawi or something, okay? Target Practice. I'm the... Well, you know, I had to show up. I had to show up just in time to get shit livened up a little bit. You know what I'm saying? I didn't even hear you guys.
Okay, now tell me about the role he plays in the film.
He plays the guy who always shows up on time.
I never showed up on time, Rich. I was always late.
Yeah, Solomon actually auditioned for the role of a CIA agent in the picture. Believe it or not, when you think of a CIA agent, you think of a guy who's sharp, on time, who's always got it together. And so I go against typecasting. So I went with Solomon there. But Solomon auditioned the role. Came in and auditioned for the role of Ron, the CIA agent, and blew me away. Just it was a great audition, and Tori, you went through the roof. You know you did. It was great stuff. Yeah. So pay no attention to this. Kind of facade. There's a serious, serious actor underneath all of that, and that's how he got the role. It was good stuff. Good stuff.
Appreciate it. Thanks, Rich.
Yeah.
Well, tell us about his role.
About the role.
Here, I loved it from the very get go. I read the audition, piece. I loved the audition. I walked in for the audition and I was ready for it. I worked on it. I loved it and I wanted to enjoy it, and that's what I went in there and did. And when my role, CIA agent. And that's where my audition was as well. I opened up, I walked in, and I'm under.
Hey,
too. We need. I'm under the influence.
Of something. let's leave that in there. Let's not fix a damn thing. I've always told Rich that. But the audition and the role is about a CIA agent who's I don't want to ruin the movie when I talk about it. You know, it's hard for me.
It's a very multifaceted, shadowy type of role, and so and both Eltony and him.
Yeah. You'll notice that. We can't talk about it. We can't talk about that. Well, you'd know too much, and then I'd have to kill you. But there's, you'll notice there's aside from the the enhancement here, but there is Solomon is humming and hawing because he's there's a reluctance to share too much about the roles because there's a lot of information. There's a lot of twists and turns in the movies. In the film, which you are so when you ask, tell us about your character. There's a lot of people. You know, there's a lot of hesitation to go. Well, my character is this guy who, you know, is up in the woods, and is that all I can say? Yeah, that's all I can say. There's a lot of twists and turns in the picture. There's a lot of twists and turns we can't talk about because, you know, they'd be classified as spoilers. Very intense performances, and you can't really go too much into the roles because there'd be spoilers. And we haven't figured out how to leap that hurdle, talk about the roles without giving away a lot of stuff, what's going on.
Okay, so which can I ask which CIA agent Joy played, or Paul goes against?
No, you can't. No, because there's a lot of twists and turns in the picture, but there is CIA involvement. There are terrorists, and anything more than that, in terms of specifics on the character, that's when you start running into these pregnant pauses in the middle of your interview. So tell us about your character.
It's a character-driven piece, absolutely.
I was going to say, it speaks to how the picture is written when... You give away too much if you go too far into your character because it's the whole film is character driven. The suspense comes from the interaction between the people and the characters. So if that's why we're a little hesitant, you give away too much just by explaining what your character does and who he is at his core. So I think that goes well to what you know Rich wrote. It shows a lot of thought.
I mean, the gist of it is five guys anywhere USA go camping in the woods somewhere, someplace that they've never been, and they end up, you know, discovering a camp for homegrown terrorists.
No, and you said too much!
Did I say too much? Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Yeah, right? Oh, my God. I mean, that's it. I'm not going to tell you what happens after that, you know, 7 billion bullets later, but, you know, what's your name? That's my line.
Why are you holding it like this? Yeah.
So I was saying, is this thing on?
Okay, well, Joy, Paul, I want to ask you, what's your heritage?
Oh, wow, my heritage. Well, my dad's American Samoan, so he's from Talofa. What was that? Yeah, thanks for the rain dance, Solomon. That's what Samoans do. Yeah,
on his lines.
Yeah, throw me a couple coconuts, man. I'm that and a little German and a little Native American, so that's it.
Okay.
Brown and white.
But I knew that because I already did an interview with you. Okay, and you play a racist person. So how did this, I mean, you must be a great actor. So how did...
Well, contrary to popular belief, not only white people can be racist. All of us can. Yeah, which is fantastic.
So are you saying you're racist?
Sometimes, yeah. Just kidding. Only I like on the 4th of July and stuff like that. when there's blaming English around. So, you know, no, but...
No.
After I started burning that cross in the front yard, I came in and said, "Let's audition."
What part did you audition for? What was the notice?
Yeah, it was the part for Paul, the role that I ended up having, and it was it's funny, it's stupid. I showed up because I thought
speaks a lot for the writer.
No, the writing is fine. I'm stupid. I showed up in this big 10-gallon cowboy hat and this and pink shirt for some reason, and I was trying to I thought racist guy, you know,
big
Texas cowboy. Well, I was trying to I don't know what. Well, the Dallas Cowboys are.
Hey, don't
are,
even go there.
Yeah, yeah, that's a whole nother thing. But no, I came in thinking I needed to try to be a little bit like that, if you know what I mean. And it was totally wrong, and that came on the heels of, you know, Brokeback Mountain just being out. There were a few jokes slammed my way, and then it was lose the hat. All right, you know, I mean, you would have thought Rich knew me for 10 years when I walked. It was like, okay, first get out of the dumb hat. You know, put that down. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, Rich has lots of adjectives to go with all the nouns.
Is that what you said?
Yes.
You know
what? First off, lose the hat. Okay. Now I'm gonna lay on the floor here, and I need you to kick the crap out of me. So that ensued. So it was, which was weird. I thought I was being set up. I was waiting for Ashton Kutcher to jump out or something.
Okay. Now your side of it.
That's in the ballpark of what went on. I just didn't think the hat was right for the character at the time. The pink shirt. It was so Joey. No,
it was more fuchsia anyway.
The pink shirt I'll live with. No, but just for the audition, he walked through the door. I said, okay, I'll throw out the lines. This is the scene we want to do. And the scene is, you know, I'm the bit I want him to audition for is a scene where he's kicking the crap out of a character on the ground. And so I want to get the intensity, I want to get the energy, and I want, you know, the lines to be able to come out with the energy, with the intensity. And so I said, all right, I'll lie down here and, you know, give you something to work with and just start kicking and, and give me that energy and give me that rage and give me, I want to be afraid of you and I want that energy. I want the lines to be coming out. I want you to be able to spit out the stuff and give me what I'm going to see in front of the camera. And there's no point in me, you know, sitting back behind a desk and telling him to do that. So I give him something to work with, and he was, all right, that's great. Now, can you do this? Can you do that? And, you know, right then, like I said, all of a sudden, I was like, uh-oh, I got to give another guy bad news now because Joey just, you know, locked this thing up. So good job.
Thanks, man.
Thanks.
Oh, well, that's like giving yourself to your craft, the lying on the floor and asking to get kicked.
I do it with my wife all the time.
Okay.
No, I will say this. We can all attest this. There's no stunt that any of us did in this film that Rich wouldn't do first. And when we questioned whether or not, should we do this? And then we would look at Sean because Sean's the stuntman. He knows if we should do this or not. And then when he would scratch his head, Rich would go, okay, look, and then Rich would do it, and then we would do it. So.
Okay.
You're a bunch of wusses if you don't do it.
Okay. Well, Sean was telling me about a couple of gags. Is that what you call them? Okay, gags that happened before he revealed that he was a stunt coordinator. So, who were any of you involved in that?
Richard was actually. You got shot before I showed up.
Yeah, you.
Yeah, yeah.
Which was you just.
Talk about the well it's well actually I should be able to talk about that. I mean, it's in the trailer, so
yeah,
it's not like
yeah,
hello well my nickname on the film was Sleep and Die, so I'm not exactly sure but basically before we had a stunt coordinator on set, we kind of improvised a little bit. There was a lot of, well, here, tape this to the side of your head, and I'm going to count to three. On two, make it kind of look like you got shot, and then on three, I want you to start falling down. But there was also a lot of really high energy things that we did that were actually really cool with the paintball gun and the little shavings that we had to shove into all the little plastic balls that fit in the paintball gun to make it look like bullets were hitting the side of the car. Those are fun, really fun and interesting things. But at the same time, you're kind of like, isn't there another way to do this? Where's the safety guy? I think I hurt myself. Yeah. Yes, Rich was the safety guy, the caterer. I don't know where the director was at the time, but he was all there. But it was really, it's a high energy, and that's what kind of made it fun, was that you were out there and, you know, you were like, well, hey, let's try this. Let's do this. Or, yeah, let's tape something to the side of your body and have it come up and have blood spurt out. And it was fun.
I had not arrived. I had not yet auditioned for it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because, I mean, one of the things that people who see the film think that, you know, they go, oh, my God, what a squib fest. You had squibs exploding all over the place. We never used any squibs. It was all done with, blood hits were done with tubing, taped to the side, tubing and prosthetics and paintball guns, which are a great double for, you know, bullet hits on trees, blah, 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 you know, stuff like that. You'd think, you know, those are squib hits in a, you know, with a bigger budget. On this, paintball guns with hollow paintballs filled with dirt, poof, on a tree, you get a big splatter on the tree, looks like a bullet hit. And so there was stuff like that. Yes. There were, you know, it was trial and error, figuring out how to do different effects, you know.
After we robbed that liquor store.
Right, after that.
Back in 05, exactly. We knew.
Oh, yeah, we can do that. But that, and you know, you improvised. But it was all, most of it was improvisation ahead of time. Like, I wanted to try doing bullet hits with paintball guns, filling up the hollow ones with the fake blood. So with lead. So I said, all right, well, let me see if I can, you know, again, I'm not going to ask the actors to do anything that I'm not going to do first. So I said, let me see if I can do this. I said, because I never shot a paintball gun. So I set up the camera in the backyard here. I had Rebecca, my wife, come up behind me with a paintball gun with a ball filled with the fake blood. I said, and started rolling the videotape. And I said, okay, shoot. And I had my shirt off. And I said, all right, shoot me in the back. And she's standing like 5 feet away with this thing. And I wanted to see, you know, how the blood splatter worked, if that would work on camera, and also how much it hurt, to tell whether I could ask the actors to do it or not. So she goes, are you sure? Are you sure you want me to do this? So yeah, go for it. Bam! No, I can't ask them to do that on a daily basis. And a welt, like my whole shoulder blade went completely black and blue. It's like, just rose. I know, we'll have to come up with something else. So we did, you know, but it was trial and error, which I did in the back. Okay, well, let's use tubing here. All this stuff went on in the backyard. We figured out how to do it in the backyard. You hadn't heard that? Yeah, okay. That one won't work. Scratch that.
Well, tell us about Rebecca Bittner.
Okay, well, Rebecca is my lovely wife. At the time, she was my girlfriend when we shot the film. Yeah, okay. When we're shooting me, she's. I was, you know, right after that. That's when she, you know, I lay down on the ground and she starts kicking me right in the shoulder blade. Let me nail that wound, would you? But Rebecca just, you know, she, you know, just completely 100% jumped on board and supported the film, and you know. Helped me prep, because when we weren't shooting, a lot of it is, that's where the producing comes in. You know, on the days that you're not directing, we're actually shooting stuff, that's where the producing comes in, because you're lining up everything that needs to be done. You're getting all the equipment and the rentals or the insurance for, you know, for the prop guns or the gunfire, you know, lining up their schedules. Everyone's got different schedules. You know, we shot it on weekends, or we shot it, you know, some people came down with bird flu on particular days to, you know, whatever. No names! No! Oh, yeah! I'm going to say that. We can't, So you get out, of work, and you'd have, and Rebecca would help putting all that together, and she, you know, she became the co-producer on the film, and, you know, she was the, all the guys say that she was the best caterer on the film. She'd be, you know, she was, I was better than me. But getting back to, we digress from what Sean, you know, with some of the stuff that we did before Sean got there was, I would say one of the biggest sequences that we did was the, scene in which is featured in the trailer as well, the scene in which Joey and Solomon fight their ways down a hillside and go leaping over all these logs and tumbling over one series of logs after another down this hillside as they're being shot at. And, you know, that we worked out before Sean got there. And we did We humped a large mattress up and down the hills, brought it up the hills.
Wow.
Wait a minute, can I rephrase that? I humped a mattress. It was a dry hump though, so it was okay. So we hauled this mattress up and down these hills, which was really heavy and big, and everyone's like, oh my God, we're hauling up and down these hills. But it was really a pain in the butt to lug around. But once you knew you're diving over that log down, which is now, it's not just a log here, but as the hill drops down, it's the leap over the log and then another few feet of drop as the hill descends. So it was a big drop. So it was nice knowing that, okay, now I know why I hauled that stupid thing up, all the way up here, so that when we dive over that log, there's something waiting for us down there besides rocks.
So were you guys scared?
I've always been a daredevil, and I've always climbed trees, and I've broken a few bones and things like that. So I love the... I love the role. I love the... and seem as clean as I could possibly seem. I didn't want the mattress. I didn't even need it. But
union rules dictated.
No. Right. Rich insisted we use the mattress. I flipped over a few logs. It was fun. I had some bumps and bruises. I shed a little blood. But it was great. It was great. I loved it. What about your blood?
My blood. I was very happy to have the mattress. The thing was wondering if it would still be where you put it. You know, where we would have it, because then it's out of view, and then you return to it. And we're still on a slope, and things are moving around a little bit. And then there were a lot of times when Solomon jumps first, he's going to hit it, roll off, and I'm wondering, will it still be there? And sometimes mid-air, it's like, it's kind of there. And then, you know, you still owe me a pair of 501s, by the way. I left my kneecap.
I've more than paid back for that with margaritas, okay?
That's true.
And barbecues, yeah.
That's true.
Okay, so that was one of the first scenes, because it was before Sean got there?
Sean really became involved. Probably we were about halfway through when Sean...
So many bones,
yeah.
Bloodshed.
Oh, God, no, you don't get this again. You don't get this again.
At a certain point, Rich probably thought it was a good idea that we bring somebody on to help with the injuries that were being sustained throughout the film. Is that right, Rich?
No, it wasn't my concern. I wasn't concerned with that at all. You forget who I am. I'm firmly of the quit whining and do it again frame of mind, you know? No, but since Sean was there...
Somebody was talking about the number of takes.
Yeah.
Hand him the mic.
Number of takes? What do you mean? These were... True.
I think you can do one so many times.
Yeah. And again. One more time. That was his favorite phrase. One more time.
I wasn't thinking about the stunts, though. Yeah. I mean, that...
Oh yeah, I'm sure these guys were jumping, climbing trees, and breaking kneecaps numerous times for the camera. Yeah.
Rattlesnakes.
Rattlesnakes.
You tiptoed into that, right?
Yeah, well, there were rattlesnakes on the set. I'm not a big fan of snakes, rattlesnakes in particular. And when there are baby rattlesnakes around, that means that there's a big mama.
What babies are the worst anyway?
So I stayed away from the big mama. And we almost stopped filming that day, didn't we?
But I chased it away for you. I chased it away for you. We sticked it out of there. Ding, 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 ding. It's gone. Okay. Ding, 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 ding. It's gone. Then beat down the grass. Okay, Eric Dean, all clear on the set for you. We've cleaned it out for you.
Okay. Well, tell me about... Okay, so it was before Sean got there that you had the thing taped to your head. Tell me how that worked.
Oh, it was... First of all, it was the first time I'd ever been killed on film. And not the last. Not real film, no. I actually shot real film before. It was actually really interesting. I'd never been part of something that was kind of had an effects element to it like that. And it was nice. It was taped a tube that kind of went up the side and inside my shirt, and then kind of came up the side of my head and sat right here and kind of off to an angle.
Who did that?
I believe it was Mr. Rydell. Yes, I believe it was. Or Rydell, however you pronounce it.
So it was the effects. Well, no, that day we had someone else there with us from an effects house. And we had, it was, her name, I can't remember the name.
We fired them once we learned.
But I was like, wait a minute. It was like, how long? I see what she's doing. And it was like, how much are you charging me to do this? And it's taking you longer to do this than I. And then one of the guys, she bloodied up way too heavily before he, okay, I turn around, I'm going to shoot something else. And then I come back to her, come back to the guy. Now we're going to do your gunshot wound where you get shot. And it looked like he was caked in blood already. I was like, wait a minute. It was like, wait a minute. Yeah, who spilled the bucket of blood over your head? It's like, you're not shot yet. We got to film it. I was like, all right, let's clean him up and do it again. And it was kind of like, and we don't want to say because then it'll give away, what happens to him. There's so many things we don't want to give. There's so many little tidbits we don't want to give away here. But so it was like, okay, I'm watching you doing this and doing that and then, okay, got it. Okay, we'll take care of that on next time around. The next scene though that we need where we actually needed the effects guys that helped us was the big climatic shootout, because there was simply so much stuff going on set that day. So much stuff we had to get, so much coverage we had to get, so much action, and everyone involved, and we had a couple days to shoot it, and it was, okay, I can't do the, I'm not going to have the time to do all that stuff now myself, I just don't have the time to do it. So that day we had to bring them on and help us out and do the effects, because I couldn't worry about doing that stuff that day. There was, it was a three-ring circus. It was like, okay, we're shooting this, and while I'm shooting this, you guys get this set up over here, and you guys get this set up over here, mm-hmm. and became this revolving like three-ring circus, just going from place to place to place to getting all these elements that figure out, and they're figuring this pretty involved big shootout at the end of the film.
Well, guy, from all these stories, I take it that you're a real can-do guy. Okay.
Yeah, okay. We were everyone was. I mean, it's the spirit of everyone sitting here. I didn't know any of these guys until until I met them all through auditioning them, and we all just clicked. And everyone here has the independent, let's make a film kind of independently spirit. And Joey's, went and did Callus, and, a bunch of us appeared in Callus. And Solomon's in Callus, Eric's in Callus, I'm in Callus. Then Eltony shot, shooting his project. I went and helped him for a day on his project and helped shoot him. And I shot a video that Solomon directed just recently. So there's a lot of stuff going on that we all are. And Bill Elverman, who's not here now, we've helped out on his project. And he had done, hey, Bill.
Hey, Bill.
Bill, he had done a picture, an independent film that he wrote and starred in, and I saw that and loved the music in it. I said, who did your music? And it was a guy back in Wisconsin, Jeff Already. So I said, you know, put me in touch with him. And I've never met Jeff face to face, but, you know, I'd send him, you know, I loved your music, Jeff. I called him up and contacted him. Loving your music, I'd like, so I sent him a copy of Target. Said, I want you to do scenes for the, you know, I want you to do the score for this. And that's, so he'd send me back cues. So Jeff, yes. Jeff Arwood, he did the music. I never met him face-to-face, but I'd send him back scenes, clips, video clips. He'd compose the music, send me back the music, where to drop it in, and I'd send him back notes on it, and he'd send me back, blah, 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 and it went back and forth. Like, but it all, he was a guy I met through Bill. I met Bill. Actually, Bill auditioned for the role because he had done a picture with Joey called The Valley Tape Murders. And, you know, I've worked with Solomon on different things now, and Eltony and Eric and Joey, and we're all working on different things together. Mm-hmm. Richard, well, Richard's always off somewhere, like in some other state doing something or other. He's busy spawning, you know, the rest. So the rest of us, are working on different projects and helping each other out.
You worked with me.
Well, I did,
You know, one thing I want to add is you were talking about the spirit of what got everything kind of going. And I don't think it was my intent, but Rich had about 10 minutes of the movie shot, and he finished it out. I mean, it was edited, it was cut, and he had temp music, temp score. And he showed that to the remainder of us. And it was some early stuff shot with Eric Dean and another actor. And by default, it put us all on the same page. So, you know, no matter where we were, you know, when you don't see a finished product, you don't know how it's going to come out. When we saw that, every one of us knew, when's it my turn? I want to do that, because what we saw was riveting, and it was edgy, and it was finished. And it was, whoa, okay. So it just set the tone, and I would recommend that to anybody moving forward, would be if they could, you know, eat 10 minutes of it before they get to work on it. I mean, it just sets, you know, if a picture's worth 1,000 words, then 10 minutes of the film is worth, you know, who knows what that's worth. But it put us all on the same page. It set the tone, and everybody wanted to play. And that was the big deal for me.
I'm sorry. What I'd also like to...
Are you happy now? You're
good. What I'd like to say also is, to put everybody on the same page. I didn't see that snippet, but one thing it would definitely take for anyone out there that's aspiring to do a film and get people behind you is be dedicated. And that's one thing that Mr. Riddell is. He is definitely dedicated. Rich has become a great friend and, you know, a mentor to a lot of guys. And he's there. He'll step up and help you on your project. He's working on other projects, and like I said before, I do it again for him because he is dedicated. I watched this guy getting freezing cold water because his cast wouldn't do it, you know, which motivated them to do that. But yeah, like he'll jump in there and do whatever it takes. If he's gonna ask you to do something, it's because he himself would do it, and you've got to credit him for that. He's an awesome guy. So just remember that. Be dedicated to your project. If it's something you believe in, you have to take one for the team as well. All right?
So. Right.
There's no crying in interviews.
So are you putting a project together from being on Target Practice?
I've got a few things in the works. So. Yeah.
And did that inspire Callis? Or?
Callis, I had written a long time ago, you know, on business trips and on the back of napkins. And, you know, when I finally was pulling all that together, it was about 200 pages of napkins and all kinds of stuff. So I didn't know where it was going or what was going to happen with that. You know, initially it was, well, that'll just get pitched somewhere or something. But definitely, you know, I was inspired by Target Practice for sure. There's no doubt about it. When I saw what Rich could do all by himself, I said, wow, if I, you know, maybe if I can get a handful of Riches, you know, maybe we can pull this off, you know. But yeah, definitely. Because I never fathomed that you could do all that, you know, that it was within your means to do it. And at the same time, that doesn't mean it is for everybody. You know, his level of... yeah, that's... I was taken to the ER twice on that project leading up to directing it. Inside of a month of doing that, I was for anxiety and panic. And, you know, it's overwhelming. So I can totally identify with Rich. You know, you've got all these actors. It's hard to stay on top of everybody. Everyone, you know... you can't wear 50 hats. Everyone's got to police their own continuity, wardrobe, all those things. You put a lot of trust in people. But Rich would check in on that avenue. He, you know, you got to make sure lunch is showing up. You got to make sure we're not getting caught out there. You know, if we're stealing a film, you know, whatever it is. There's so many things to think about. Rich had to think about every prop that was going to be out there. And, you know, and again, the producing that went on in between. You know, we shot. It seemed like it was.
And the location scouting.
Location scouting. You're pretty, you know.
Absolutely.
It,
yeah.
Absolutely.
So. Inspired me as well. To get a project done. Yes, I had a little brother with an album in stores with, from Sony. He's a rapper, R&B. His name is Vicious Automatic. Makes great music. I made a song with him. Rich inspired me to put together a video. I asked him for his help, and we made a great video. You can catch it on YouTube, King Solomon XXX, Pop Off Music, Battlefish Productions. Check it out. You're going to love it. Rich inspired me to make it happen.
Man, I have so many more things I want to ask you. Okay, tell us about how you got the movie distributed.
Well, you know, I had mentioned, I talked to you before about Charades. Actually, the company that made Charades is eventually the Kimberly Cates was in Charades. Stephen Eckleberry was the director of Charades. Mm-hmm. They formed a company, Big Screen Entertainment, and there were so many distribution deals that we got offered on Target Practice, but by far Big Screen was the people that I felt safest about going with, and that's where Big Screen Entertainment Group
Big Screen,
came into
thank
it.
You. Thank you so
okay.
much.
Okay, yeah, let's let you in.
Oh, Big Screen, Target Practice, Battlefish Productions.
Thanksgiving release,
November 23rd. Look us up. Find us, King Solomon XXX YouTube. Everybody, we love you, baby.
That's great. Okay, thank you.
We have this effect, yes, guys.
I don't know how to follow that. These guys are great. Target Practice is opening November 23rd, or is coming to DVD on November 23rd. Make sure that you get it at Amazon.
Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Borders, and then Netflix in a couple weeks after that.
It's a great movie, so get it.
Target Practice, baby!
ION Entertainment.
Oh, yeah.
ION Entertainment.